Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of Out Stealing Horses by Per Petterson, translated from the Norwegian by Anna Born, narrated by Richard Poe, and directed by Jenny Selig. This book is copyrighted 2003 by Per Petterson. This translation is copyrighted 2005 by Anna Born. This recording is copyrighted 2008 by Recorded Books. Per Petterson is considered one of Europe's finest contemporary novelists. Out Stealing Horses has won him acclaim and awards throughout the world. It records the changing and ever-elusive dance of time through the voice of 67-year-old Trond Sander, facing both a latticework of remembrance and the here and now of contemporary Europe. And now, Out Stealing Horses.
Part 1. Chapter 1. Early November. It's 9 o'clock. The titmice are banging against the window. Sometimes they fly dizzily off after the impact. Other times they fall and lie struggling in the new snow until they can take off again. I don't know what they want that I have. I look out the window at the forest. There's a reddish light over the trees by the lake. It's starting to blow. I can see the shape of the wind on the water. I live here now, in a small house in the far east of Norway. A river flows into the lake. It's not much of a river, and it gets shallow in the summer, but in the spring and autumn it runs briskly. And there are trout in it. I've caught some myself. The mouth of the river is only 100 meters from here. I can just see it from my kitchen window once the birch leaves have fallen. As now, in November. There is a cottage down by the river that I can see when its lights are on, if I go out onto my doorstep. A man lives there. He's older than I am, I think. Or he seems to be. But perhaps that's because I don't realize what I look like myself. Or life has been tougher for him than it has been for me. I can't rule that out. He has a dog, a border collie. I have a bird table on a pole a little way out in my yard. When it's getting light in the morning, I sit at the kitchen table with a cup of coffee and watch them come fluttering in. I've seen 8 different species so far, which is more than anywhere else I've lived. But only the titmice fly into the window. I've lived in many places. Now I'm here. When the light comes, I've been awake for several hours, stoked the fire, walked around, read yesterday's paper, washed yesterday's dishes. There were not many. Listened to the BBC. I keep the radio on most of the day. I listen to the news. Cannot break that habit, but I don't know what to make of it anymore. They say 67 is no age, not nowadays, and it doesn't feel it either. I feel pretty spry. But when I listen to the news, it no longer has the same place in my life. It doesn't affect my view of the world as once it did. Maybe there's something wrong with the news, the way it's reported. Maybe there's too much of it. The good thing about the BBC's World Service, which is broadcast early in the morning, is that everything sounds foreign, that nothing is said about Norway, and that I can get updated on the position of countries like Jamaica, Pakistan, India, and Sri Lanka in a sport such as cricket. A game I have never seen played and never will see if I have a say in the matter. But what I have noticed is that the motherland, England, is constantly being beaten. That's always something. I too have a dog. Her name is Lura. What breed she is wouldn't be easy to say. It's not that important. We've been out already with a torch. On the path we usually take, along the lake with its few millimeters of ice up against the bank where the dead rushes are yellow with autumn, and the snow fell silently, heavily, out of the dark sky above, making Lura sneeze with delight. Now she lies there close to the stove, asleep. It stops snowing. As the day wears on, it'll all melt. I can tell that from the thermometer. The red column is rising with the sun. All my life I've longed to be alone in a place like this. even when everything was going well, as it often did. I can say that much, that it often did. I've been lucky. But even then, for instance, in the middle of an embrace and someone whispering words in my ear I wanted to hear, I could suddenly get a longing to be in a place where there was only silence. Years might go by, and I didn't think about it, but that doesn't mean that I didn't long to be there. And now I'm here, and it's almost exactly as I'd imagined it. In less than 2 months' time, this millennium will be finished. There will be festivities and fireworks in the parish I'm part of. I shall not go near any of that. I'll stay at home with Lura. Perhaps go for a walk down to the lake to see if the ice will carry my weight. I'm guessing -10 and moonlight. And then I'll stoke the fire, put a record on the old gramophone with Billie Holiday's voice, almost a whisper, like when I heard her in the Oslo Coliseum sometime in the 50s. Almost burned out, yet still magic. And then, fittingly, get drunk on a bottle I have standing by in the cupboard. When the record ends, I'll go to bed and sleep as heavily as it's possible to sleep without being dead. And awake to a new millennium, and not let it mean a thing. I'm looking forward to that. In the meantime, I'm spending my days getting this place in order. There's quite a lot that needs doing. I didn't pay much for it. In fact, I'd been prepared to shell out a lot more to lay my hands on the house and the grounds, but there wasn't much competition. I do understand why now, but it doesn't matter. I'm pleased anyway. I tried to do most of the work myself, even though I could have paid a carpenter. I'm far from skint, but then it would have gone too fast. I want to use the time it takes. Time is important to me now, I tell myself. Not that it should pass quickly or slowly, but be only time, something I live inside and fill with physical things and activities that I can divide it up by, so that it grows distinct to me and doesn't vanish when I'm not looking. Something happened last night. I had gone to bed in the small room beside the kitchen, where I put a temporary bed up under the window, and I'd fallen asleep. It was past midnight, and it was pitch dark outside. Going out for a last pee behind the house, I could feel the cold. I give myself that liberty. For the time being, there's nothing but an outdoor toilet here. No one can see, anyway, the forest standing thick to the west. What woke me was a loud, penetrating sound, repeated at brief intervals, followed by silence, and then starting again. I sat up in bed, opened the window a crack, and looked out. Through the darkness, I could see the yellow beam of a torch a little way down the road by the river. The person holding the torch must be the one making the sound I'd heard, but I couldn't understand what kind of sound it was or why he was making it, if it was a he. Then the ray of light swung aimlessly to right and left, as if resigned, and I caught a glimpse of the lined face of my neighbor. He had something in his mouth that looked like a cigar. And then the sound came again, and I realized it was a dog whistle, although I had never seen one before. And he started to call the dog. Poker, he shouted. Poker, which was the dog's name. Come here, boy, he shouted. And I lay down in bed again and closed my eyes, but I knew I wouldn't get back to sleep. All I wanted was to sleep. I've grown fussy about the hours I get. And although there are not many, I need them in a completely different way than before. A ruined night throws a dark shadow for many days ahead and makes me irritable and feel out of place. I have no time for that. I need to concentrate. All the same, I sat up in bed again, swung my legs in the pitch black to the floor, and found my clothes over the back of the chair. I had to gasp when I felt how cold they were. Then I went through the kitchen and into the hall and pulled on my old pea jacket, took the torch from the shelf, and went out onto the steps. It was coal black. I opened the door again, put my hand in, and switched on the outside light. That helped. The red-painted outhouse wall threw a warm glow across the yard. I've been lucky, I say to myself. I can go out to a neighbor in the night when he's searching for his dog, and it'll take me only a couple of days and I'll be okay again. I switched on the torch and began walking down the road from the yard towards where he was still standing on the gentle slope, swinging his torch so that the beam moved slowly round in a circle towards the edge of the forest, across the road, along the riverbank, and back to its starting point. "Poker!" he called. "Poker!" And then blew the whistle, and the sound had an unpleasantly high frequency in the quiet of the night, and his face, his body, were hidden in the darkness. I didn't know him, had only spoken to him a few times on the way past his cottage when I was out with Lura, most often at quite an early hour, and I suddenly felt like going back in again and forgetting all about it. What could I do, anyway? But now he must have seen the light of my torch, and it was too late. And after all, there was something about this character I could barely make out there in the night alone. He ought not to be alone like that. It wasn't right. "Hello," I called quietly, mindful of the silence. He turned, and for a moment I couldn't see anything. The beam of his torch hit me straight in the face. And when he realized that, he aimed the torch down. I stood still for a few seconds to recover my night vision. Then I walked to where he was, and we stood there together, each with our bright beam pointing from hip height at the landscape around us. And nothing resembled what it looked like by day. I've grown accustomed to the dark. I can't remember ever being afraid of it, but I must have been, and now it feels natural and safe and transparent, no matter how much, in fact, is hidden there, though that means nothing. Nothing can challenge the lightness and freedom of the body. Height unconfined, distance unlimited. For these aren't the properties of darkness. It's only an immeasurable space to move about inside. "He's run off again," said my neighbor. "Poker, my dog, that is. It happens. He always comes back. But it's hard to sleep when he's gone like that. There are wolves in the forest now. At the same time, I feel I can't keep the door shut." He seems a bit embarrassed. I probably would be if it were my dog. I don't know what I'd do if Lura had run off, whether I'd go out by myself to search for her. "Did you know that they say the border collie is the most intelligent dog in the world?" he said. "I have heard that," I said. "He's smarter than I am, Poker, and he knows it." My neighbor shook his head. "He's about to take charge, I'm afraid." "Well, that's not so good," I said. "No," he said. It struck me that we had never really introduced ourselves, so I raised my hand, shining the torch on it so he could see it, and said, "Trond Sander." That confused him. It took him a moment or two to change his torch to his left hand and take my right hand with his, and then he said, "Lars. Lars Haug. With a G." "How do you do?" I said. And it sounded as bizarre and strange out there in the dark night as when my father said condolences at a funeral in the depths of the forest many, many years ago. And immediately I regretted saying those four words. But Lars Haug didn't seem to notice. Maybe he thought it was the proper thing to say, and that the situation was no odder than it might be whenever grown men greet each other in a field. There was silence all around us. There had been days and nights of rain and wind and incessant roaring in the pines and the spruce, but now there was absolute stillness in the forest, not a shadow moving. And we stood still, my neighbor and I, staring into the dark. Then I felt certain there was something behind me. I couldn't escape the sudden feeling of sheer cold down my back, and Lars Haug felt it too. He directed his torchlight at a point a couple of meters past me, and I turned, and there stood Poker, quite stiff and on guard. I've seen that before, how a dog can both sense and show the feeling of guilt. And like most of us, it was something it didn't like, especially when its owner started talking to it in an almost childlike tone of voice, which didn't go well with the weather-beaten, lined face of a man who had undoubtedly been out on a cold night before and dealt with wayward things, complicated things, and a contrary wind, things of high gravity. I could tell that when we shook hands. "Ah, where have you been, Poker, you stupid dog? Been disobedient to your daddy again? Shame on you, bad boy, shame on you, that's no way to behave." And he took a step towards the dog, and it started growling deep down in its throat, flattening its ears. Lars Haug stopped in his tracks. He let his torch sink until it shone directly on the ground, and I could just pick out the white patches of the dog's coat, the black ones blending with the night. And it all looked strangely at odds and unsymmetrical as the growl, low in the animal's throat, went on from a slightly less definite point. And my neighbor said, "I have shot a dog once before, and I promised myself then that I would never do it again. But now I don't know." He had lost his confidence, it was clear. He couldn't work out his next move, and I suddenly felt desperately sorry for him. The feeling welled up from I don't know where, from someplace out in the dark, where something might have happened in a different time entirely, or from somewhere in my own life I had long since forgotten, and it made me embarrassed and ill at ease. I cleared my throat, and in a voice I couldn't wholly control, I said, "What kind of dog was it that you had to shoot?" Although I don't think that was what I was interested in, I had to say something to calm the sudden trembling in my chest. "An Alsatian, but it wasn't mine. It happened on the farm where I grew up. My mother saw it first. It ran around at the edge of the forest hunting roe deer. Two terrified young fawns we'd several times seen from the window grazing in the brushwood at the edge of the North Meadow. They always kept close, and they did so then. The Alsatian chased them, encircled them, bit at their hocks, and they were exhausted and didn't stand a chance. My mother couldn't bear to look any longer, so she phoned the bailiff and asked him what to do, and he said, 'You'll just have to shoot it.' 'That's a job for you, Lars,' she said, when she had put the receiver down. 'Do you think you can manage it?' 'I didn't want to. I must say I hardly ever touched that gun. But I felt really sorry for the fawns, and I couldn't exactly ask her to do it, and there was no one else at home. My big brother was away at sea, and my stepfather was in the forest felling timber for the neighboring farmer, as he usually did at that time of year. So I fetched the gun and walked across the meadow towards the forest. When I got there, I couldn't see the dog anywhere. I stood still, listening. It was autumn. The air was really clear in the middle of the day, and the quietness was almost uncanny. I turned and looked back to the house, where I knew my mother was by the window watching everything I did. She wasn't going to let me off. I looked into the forest again, along a path, and there suddenly I saw the two roe deer running in my direction. I knelt down and raised the gun and laid my cheek to the barrel, and the big fawns were so frantic with terror that they didn't notice me. Oh, they hadn't the strength to worry about yet another enemy. They didn't change course at all, but ran straight at me and rushed past a hand's breadth from my shoulder. I heard them panting and saw the whites of their wide, staring eyes. Lars Haug paused, raised the torch and shone it on Poker, who hadn't moved from his place just behind me. I didn't turn, but I heard the dog's low growl. It was a disturbing sound, and the man in front of me bit his lip and ran the fingers of his left hand over his forehead with an uncertain movement before he went on. 30 meters after them came the Alsatian. It was a huge beast. I fired immediately. I'm sure I hit it, but it didn't change speed or direction. A shudder might have run through its body. I really don't know, so I fired again, and it went down on its knees and got up again and kept on running. I was quite desperate and let off a third round. It was just a few meters from me, and it somersaulted and fell with its legs in the air and slid right up to the toes of my boots. But it wasn't dead. It lay there, paralyzed, looking straight up at me. And I felt sorry for it then. I must say, so I bent down to give it a last pat on the head, and it growled and snapped at my hand. I jumped back. It made me furious, and I gave it 2 more rounds right through the head. Lars Haug stood there, with his face barely visible, the torch hanging tiredly from his hand, throwing only a small yellow disk of light on the ground. Pine needles, pebbles, 2 fir cones. Poker stood dead still without a sound, and I wondered whether dogs can hold their breath. "Bloody hell," I said. "I was just 18," he said. "It's long ago, but I'll never forget it." "Then I can well understand why you'll never shoot a dog again," I said.
"We'll see about that," said Lars Haug. "But now I'd better take this one inside. It's late." "Come, Poker," he said, his voice sharp now, and started to walk down the road. Poker followed him obediently, some meters behind. When they came to the little bridge, Lars Haug stopped and waved his torch.
"Thank you for the company," he said through the darkness. I waved my torch and turned to walk up the gentle slope to the house and opened the door and went into the lighted hall. For some reason, I locked the door behind me, something I haven't done since I moved out here. I didn't like doing it, but all the same, I did. I undressed and lay down in bed under the duvet, staring at the ceiling, waiting for the warmth to come. I felt a bit foolish. Then I closed my eyes. At some point while I was asleep, it started to snow, and I'm sure I was aware of it in my sleep, that the weather changed and grew colder. And I knew I feared the winter, and I feared the snow if there was too much of it, and the fact that I had put myself in an impossible position moving here. So then I dreamt fiercely about summer, and it was still in my head when I woke up. I could have dreamt of any summer at all, but I didn't. It turned out to be a very special summer, and I still think of it now when I sit at the kitchen table, watching the light spread above the trees by the lake. Nothing looks as it did last night, and I can't think of a single reason for locking the door. I'm tired, but not as tired as I expected to be. I'll last until evening. I know I will. I get up from the table, a little stiff. That back isn't what it used to be. And Lura, by the stove, raises her head and looks at me. "Are we going out again?" "We aren't. Not yet. I have enough to do thinking about this summer, which begins to trouble me. And that it hasn't done for many years." Chapter 2. We were going out stealing horses. That was what he said, standing at the door to the cabin where I was spending the summer with my father. I was 15. It was 1948, and one of the first days of July. 3 years earlier, the Germans had left. But I can't remember that we talked about them any longer. At least my father didn't. He never said anything about the war. Jun came often to our door, at all hours, wanting me to go out with him, shooting hares, walking through the forest in the pale moonlight right up to the top of the ridge when it was perfectly quiet, fishing for trout in the river, balancing on the shining yellow logs that still sailed the current close to our cabin long after the clearing of the river was done. It was risky, but I never said no, and never said anything to my father about what we were up to. We could see a stretch of the river from the kitchen window, but it wasn't there that we did our balancing acts. We always started further down, nearly a kilometer, and sometimes we went so far and so fast on the logs that it took us an hour to walk back through the forest when at last we had scrambled onto the bank, soaking wet and shivering. Yoon wanted no company but mine. He had 2 younger brothers, the twins Lars and Odd, but he and I were the same age. I don't know who he was with for the rest of the year, when I was in Oslo. He never talked about that, and I never told him what I did in the city. He never knocked, just came quietly up the path from the river, where his little boat was tied up, and waited at the door until I became aware that he was there. It never took long. Even in the morning, early, when I was still asleep, I might feel a restlessness far into my dream, as if I needed to pee and struggled to wake up before it was too late. And then when I opened my eyes and knew it wasn't that, I went directly to the door and opened it, and there he was. He smiled his little smile and squinted, as he always did. "Are you coming?" he said. "We're going out stealing horses." It turned out that we meant only him and me, as usual. And if I hadn't gone with him, he would have gone alone, and that would have been no fun. Besides, it was hard to steal horses alone. Impossible, in fact. "Have you been waiting long?" I said. "I just got here." That's what he always said, and I never knew if it was true. I stood on the doorstep in only my underpants and looked over his shoulder. It was already light. There were wisps of mist on the river, and it was a little cold. It would soon warm up, but now I felt goose pimples spread over my thighs and stomach. Yet I stood there looking down to the river, watching it coming from round the bend a little further up, shining and soft from under the mist, and flow past. I knew it by heart. I had dreamt about it all winter. "Which horses?" I said. "Barkal's horses. He keeps them in the paddock in the forest, behind the farm." "I know. Come inside while I get dressed." "I'll wait here," he said. He never would come inside, maybe because of my father. He never spoke to my father, never said hello to him, just looked down when they passed each other on the way to the shop. Then my father would stop and turn round to look at him and say, "Wasn't that Yoon?" "Yes," I said. "What's wrong with him?" said my father, every time, as if embarrassed. And each time I said, "I don't know." And in fact, I didn't. I never thought to ask. Now Yoon stood on the doorstep that was only a flagstone, gazing down at the river, while I fetched my clothes from the back of one of the tree-trunk chairs and pulled them on as quickly as I could. I didn't like him having to stand there waiting, even though the door was open so he could see me the whole time. Clearly I ought to have understood there was something special about that July morning, something to do with the fog on the river and the mist over the ridge, perhaps. Something about the white light in the sky. Something in the way Yoon said what he had to say, or the way he moved, or stood there stock still at the door. But I was only 15, and the only thing I noticed was that he didn't carry the gun he always had with him in case a hare should cross our path. And that wasn't so strange. It would only have been in the way, rustling horses. We weren't going to shoot the horses, after all. As far as I could see, he was the same as he always was, calm and intense at one and the same time, with his eyes squinting, concentrating on what we were going to do, with no sign of impatience. That suited me well, for it was no secret that compared with him, I was a slow coach in most of our exploits. He had years of training behind him. The only thing I was good at was riding logs down the river. I had a built-in balance, a natural talent, Yoon thought, though that was not how he would have put it. What he had taught me to be was reckless. Taught me that if I let myself go, didn't slow myself down by thinking so much beforehand, I could achieve many things I would never have dreamt possible. "Okay, ready, steady, go," I said. We set off together down the path to the river. It was very early. The sun came gliding over the ridge with its fan of light and gave to everything a brand new color, and what was left of the fog above the water melted and disappeared. I felt the instant warmth through my sweater and closed my eyes and walked on without once missing my footing until I knew we had got to the bank. Then I opened my eyes and clambered down the stream-washed boulders and into the stern of the little boat. Yoon pushed off and jumped in, picked up the oars and rowed with short, hard strokes straight into the stream. Let the boat drift a stretch and rowed again until we reached the opposite shore about 50 meters further down, far enough for the boat not to be seen from the cottage. Then we climbed up the slope. Yoon first, with me at his heels, and walked along the barbed wire fence by the meadow, where the grass stood tall under a light veil of mist, and would soon be mowed and hung on racks to dry in the sun. It was like walking up to your hips in water, with no resistance, as in a dream. I often dreamt about water then. I was friends with water. It was Barkle's field, and we had come this way many times, up between the fields to the road that led to the shop, to buy magazines or sweets or other things we had the money for. 1 ura, 2 ura, and sometimes 5 ura coins jingling in our pockets every step we took. Or we went to Yoon's house in the other direction, where his mother greeted us so enthusiastically when we walked in, you would have thought I was the crown prince or something. And his father dived into the local paper, or vanished out to the barn on some errand that just couldn't wait. There was something there I didn't understand, but it didn't worry me. He could stay in the barn as far as I was concerned. I didn't give a damn. Whatever happened, I was going home at summer's end. Barkle's farm was on the far side of the road, behind some fields where he grew oats and barley every other year, close up to the forest with the barn at an angle. And in the forest he kept 4 horses in a large area he had fenced in with barbed wire, from tree to tree at 2 heights. It was his forest, and there was a lot of it. He was the biggest landowner in the district. Neither of us could stand the man, but I'm not sure why. He had never done anything to us, or uttered an unfriendly word that I had ever heard. But he had a big farm, and Yoon was the son of a smallholder. Almost everyone was a smallholder alongside the river in this valley, only a few kilometers from the Swedish border. And most of them still lived off the produce of their farms and the milk they delivered to the dairy, and as lumberjacks in the logging season for Barkle in his forest, or elsewhere, and in the one owned by a rich bastard from Barum. Thousands and thousands of parcels of land to the north and the west. There wasn't much money about, as far as I could make out. Maybe Barkle had some, but Yoon's father had none, and my father certainly didn't have any, not that I knew about, anyhow. So how he had scraped together enough to buy the cabin where we stayed that summer is still a mystery. Frankly, I never had a clear idea what my father did to earn a living, to keep his life going, and mine, among others, because it often seemed to change from one thing to another. But there were always numerous tools involved, and small machines, and sometimes a great deal of planning and thinking with pencil in hand, and journeys to all kinds of places around the country, places where I had never been and never knew what they looked like. But he was no longer on any other man's payroll. Often he had a great deal to do, at other times less, but still he had managed to save enough money. And when we went there for the first time the year before, he walked round, looking things over and smiling a secret smile, and patting the trees, and sitting on a big stone on the river bank, his chin in his hand, looking out over the water as if he were among old friends. But of course it couldn't have been so, could it? Yoon and I left the meadow path and walked down the road. And although we had been this way many times before, it was different now. We were out stealing horses, and we knew it showed. We were criminals. That changes people. It changes something in their faces and gives them a particular way of walking no one can do anything about. And stealing horses, that was the worst thing of all. We knew about the law west of Pecos. We had read the cowboy magazines. And although maybe we could say that we were east of Pecos, it was so far east that you might just as well say it the other way around, as it depended on which way you chose to look at the world. But with that law, there was no mercy. If you were caught, it was straight up a tree with a rope round your neck. Rough hemp against the tender flesh. Someone whacked the horse on its rump and it flew out from under your legs, and then you ran for your life in bottomless air while that very life flashed past in review with fainter and fainter images until they were empty of your own self and of all you had seen, and then filled with fog and finally turned black. Just 15 was your last thought. That wasn't much, and all for a horse
and then everything was too late.
Barkall's house sat heavy and gray at the edge of the forest, and it seemed more threatening than ever. The windows were dark so early in the morning, but maybe he was standing there looking down the road and could see the way we were walking and knew. But it was too late to turn around now. We walked stiff-legged a couple of hundred meters down the gravel road until the house disappeared round a bend, then up another path across another field that was Barkle's too, and into the forest. At first the wood was thick and dark among the spruce trunks, with no underbrush at all, only deep green moss like a huge carpet that was soft to walk on, for the light never wholly found its way in here. And we walked along the path, one in front of the other, and felt it yield each time we put a foot down. Yoon first, with me at his heels on worn gym shoes. Then we turned off in a curve, still to the right, the space in the light above us gradually expanding, until suddenly we saw the two strands of barbed wire glinting, and we were there. We looked in at a clearing where all the spruce had been felled, and the sapling pine and birch trees were standing strangely tall and solitary, with no shelter at their backs. And some of them hadn't survived the wind from the north, and had fallen full length with their roots in the air. Between the spruce stumps the grass was growing lush and thick, and behind some bushes further on we saw the horses, only their rumps visible, tails swishing horseflies. We smelled the horse droppings and the wet, boggy moss and the sweet, sharp, all-pervading odor of something greater than ourselves and beyond our comprehension, of the forest, which just went on and on to the north and into Sweden and over to Finland and further on the whole way to Siberia. And you could get lost in this forest and 100 people go searching for weeks without a chance of finding you. And why should that be so bad, I wondered, to get lost here? But I didn't know then how serious that thought was. Yoon bent down and crawled between the two rows of barbed wire with his hand pressing down on the lower one, and I lay on the ground and rolled underneath the lower one. And we came through without a tear in either trousers or sweaters. We got warily to our feet and walked through the grass towards the horses.
"That birch over there," said Yoon, pointing. "Climb into it."
A big birch tree stood apart, not far from the horses, with strong branches, the lowest of them 3 meters off the ground. Without hesitation, I walked softly over to the tree. The horses raised their heads and turned them towards me as I approached, but they stayed where they were, still munching, without shifting. Yoon walked around them in a semicircle from the other side. I kicked off my shoes, put both hands behind the birch, and found a firm foothold in the crack of the bark, then placed my other foot flat against the trunk, and so climbed up monkey-wise until I could get my left hand around the branch, and I leaned over and took hold with my right hand and let my feet slide off the rough trunk, and then I hung by my hands for a moment before hoisting myself up and sat there with feet dangling. I could do things like that in those days.
"Okay," I called quietly. "Ready."
Yoon squatted in front of the horses and talked to them in a low voice. And they stood quite still with their heads towards him and their ears pushed forward, listening to what was almost a whisper. Anyway, I couldn't hear what he said from where I sat on the branch. But when I had called "Okay," he sprang up, shouting, "Hoy!" and stretched out his arms. And the horses wheeled round and started to run. Not very fast, but not very slow either. And two stampeded to the left, and two came straight for my tree.
"Be prepared,"
Yoon called, and shot 3 fingers up in the air in a Boy Scout salute.
"Always prepared,"
I called back, twisted around with my stomach against the branch, kept my balance with my hands, and opened my legs in the air like a pair of scissors. I felt a faint drumming in my chest from the hooves on the ground and up through the tree and a trembling from a quite different place, from inside myself. And it started in the stomach and settled in my hips. But it couldn't be helped, so I didn't think about it. I was ready. And then the horses were there. I heard their hard breathing, and the vibration in the tree grew stronger.
and the sound of the hooves filled my head. And when I could just about see the muzzle of the nearest one beneath me, I slid off the branch with my legs stiffly to the sides, and I let go and landed on the horse's back, a bit too close to its neck. And its shoulder bones hit me in the crotch and sent a jet of nausea up into my throat. It looked so simple when Zorro did it in the film, but now tears began to flow, and I had to be sick and at the same time keep a firm hold of the mane with both hands. And I bent forwards and pressed my lips tight shut. The horse tossed its head wildly, and its back beat against my crotch, and it accelerated into a full gallop, and the other horse followed suit, and together we thundered off among the tree trunks. I heard Yoon yell, "Yahoo!" behind me, and I felt like yelling too, but I couldn't do it. My mouth was so full of sick that I couldn't breathe. And then I let it pour onto the neck under me. Now there was a faint smell of sick and a lot of horse, and I couldn't hear Yoon's voice anymore. There was a rushing sound, and the hoofbeats died down, and the horse's back drummed through my body like the beating of my heart. And then there was a sudden silence around me that spread over everything, and through that silence I heard the birds. I distinctly heard the blackbird from the top of a spruce tree. And clear as glass, I heard the lark high up, and several other birds whose song I didn't know. And it was so weird. It was like a film without sound with another sound added. I was in two places at once, and nothing hurt. "Yahoo!" I screamed. And I could hear my own voice, but it seemed to be coming from a different place, from the great space where the birds sang. A bird's cry from inside that silence. And for a moment I was completely happy. My chest swelled up like an accordion's bellows, and each time I breathed, there were notes coming out. And then I saw something sparkle through the trees in front of me. It was the barbed wire. We had galloped right across the clearing and were approaching the fence on the other side at great speed, and the horse's back beat hard against my crotch again, and I clung hard to the mane and thought, "We're going to jump." But we didn't jump. Just before the fence, both horses turned sharply, and the laws of physics tore me from my horse's back and sent me kicking and flailing on in a straight line through the air and right over the fence. I felt the wire tear at the sleeve of my sweater and a smarting pain, and then I was lying in the heather, and the impact knocked the air out of my body. I think I was unconscious for a few seconds, because I remember I opened my eyes as if to a new beginning. Nothing I saw was familiar to me. My head was empty, no thoughts, everything quite clean, and the sky transparently blue. And I didn't know what I was called or even recognize my own body. Unnamed, I floated around, looking at the world for the first time, and felt it strangely illuminated and glassily beautiful. And then I heard a whinny, and the thundering of hooves, and it all came back like a whirring boomerang and hit me on the forehead with a crack, and I thought, "Shit, I'm paralyzed." I looked down at my bare feet sticking out of the heather, and they had no connection with me. I was still lying there flat out when I saw Yoon on horseback with a rope round the horse's muzzle come up to the fence. With the rope, he could control it. He stopped just on the other side by pulling the rope, and the horse halted almost sideways to the fence. He looked down at me. "Lying there, are you?" he said. "I'm paralyzed," I said. "I don't think so," he said. "Maybe not," I said. I looked down at my feet again, and then I stood up.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.